This is Africa International Network.
Okay, and now straight to our debate. We're going to have it as short as we can. We'll try to talk about African music, and we'll talk about the past, the present, and the future of African music. Today, to do this with me, there is Hanbala Djalo, who is from Senegal, but of Guinea-Bissau origin. He's a musical critic. And then there is ManLuckerz over there, to my extreme right. He's from Zimbabwe. He's a musician. He's been performing here in Sweden for quite some years. And then there is Celso Paco as well, who's from Mozambique, a musician as well. And he's been performing too, together with ManLuckerz in the same band. We're gonna have them perform for us shortly. So, ladies and gentlemen, thanks for showing up. And dear panelists, thanks for coming. Let us go straight to the business.
Okay.
African music, the past of African music. First, I want to call a few names and see if it makes sense to you, okay? If I say, for instance, sorry, it might be a little embarrassing, but if I say Miriam Makeba, would you tell me what country that person is?
Miriam Makeba, she's from South Africa. She's a musician, and she was fighting a lot against apartheid to make her to exile to Guinea. And yes.
Thank you. That's correct. And if I, not to you, but if I just ask the question, if I call the name Yusundu, would it make sense to you guys over there?
Absolutely.
Yusundur
is one of the biggest names of the African music. It represents Africa in the world. And I can say I feel proud to have been sharing stage with Yusundur.
Yeah,
both in Sweden and in England.
And if I call the name Angelique Kidjo, for instance, would it make sense to any of you guys?
Right. Another name?
What I can say is, actually, those people actually you've mentioned, for us, actually, they are quite heroes. And those are the people who gave us confidence to do what we are trying to do, to build bridges between cultures. And that's what we are fighting for. Yes, together we can win. We can go far.
Okay. And what I can say about Angelique Kidjo, she's from Benin. And right now she's living in the USA. She's a great musician. And she's a pan-Africanist, and she's a feminist too. And she's a lot in the fight for the women in the world. And that's generally what we talk about. But she has been having a lot of success, a lot of his successes have been in the hits in the world, and she has been winning a lot of Grammys and awards and things like that.
Yeah, she's an award winner. That's correct.
She was in Sweden. She was in Sweden a couple of years ago in Uppsala.
Oh, okay.
To do a very great show at the conference center. Great show.
Okay, after setting that scene, I would want to ask you, how would you characterize African music from, say, the 60s or 70s up to the 90s? How would you characterize it? Hanbala, I would start with you.
Yeah, the African music we come now from my vision is that I start from the independence, after the independence went, For example, my the African music I know most it's about the French and the French speaking countries or the Portuguese speaking countries. For example, in the 60s after the independence, for example, it was a lot about in Senegal. It was a lot. The music was influenced from the Cubanese, and you were seeing a lot of bands who was playing Cubanese music. That time it was the beginning of this, the merengue and things like the charanga. And it's influenced something we called mbala, the Senegalese drum called mbala, which made it existed a lot of groups like Orchestra Baobab, Africando that time, and for example in Congo that time it was the rumba. It was to African music. Who is connected to little about Cubanese?
You had Franco, for instance.
Yeah, the Franco, Rochero, and the Franco, Rochero, Tabule. Yeah, and yeah, exactly. And in Ivory Coast, you was having like Jonas Pedro. He's from Benin and things like that. And when in Cameroon it was a lot in African French speaking countries, it was more about Congolese, but it came to the Cameroonian style. That time, for example, you was hearing the beginning of the Makossa, the end of the 60s, the 70s. Makossa is a Cameroonese music created, it comes from the Douala people. It's a little area in Douala city where you have that people. It's a music was quite...
it's been very influential.
Yeah, very influential. That influenced a lot the African music. But the problem with the Makossa compared to others is that the Makossa was just a little part of this, the Cameroonese people who was playing that, a little group, the Douala people.
Yeah.
But for example, the Rumba in Congo, it's the whole Congolese who was adhering to that kind of music. But
probably in the case of
exactly. And that time you were seeing like Edouard Lotin, Bill Loco, and a lot of them until, the French-speaking countries, it was more or less like that.
Yeah, but I'll come back to you, Hanbala. ManLuckerz, you playing sort of traditional, but at the same time contemporary music, right? I don't know, my knowledge of music from Zimbabwe is not so good, but I know of Oliver Tukutukuzi.
Yeah, sure.
Is there any other person or any other persons that have been influential in the musical scene in that area?
Yeah, actually, if we look back, especially early 60s or till 1990 or something like that, we did have special musicians such as Oliver Mtukudzi and Thomas Mapfumo, Leonard Dembo, Johnny Chibaduya, and all others. So if we look at Thomas Mapfumo, he is one of the best Zimbabwean traditional musician who started to bring out the traditional music from Zimbabwe to Europe, America, and actually he is the one who gave us more confidence of how to present our African music in Europe.
And I would ask Celso, What is it about African music at that time that interested you in terms of, I don't know, the content or the themes or the different instruments that were played? What was it in particular that pricked you as a musician yourself?
I can say that around the 60s, the music scene in Mozambique, like the popular music, the traditional music, was quite undermined because the bands were more, they promoted more rock and roll, like local musicians would play like in clubs and even in weddings, they'll play rock and roll, twist and all European American music. But in the 70s, when the colonial power understood that they're starting to lose terrain, so they decided to adopt a tactic to join, to mix the local music that was being played in the countryside and mix it with westernized music. Mm-hmm. And there was a particular music style called marrabenta, where people in the countryside would play with the tin guitar, because at that time people would not afford to buy a guitar, so it would make a tin guitar with 5 liters oil,
yeah,
and a piece of wood, so with the fishing line, so one would make some kind of guitar, and then they would play. Yeah, people will dance until the strings go off. So they call the Portuguese name is rebentar. So people adopted the name rebentar to marrabenta. So play the music till the strings go off, or you dance until you explode. So the Portuguese, they adapted that marrabenta music and they made it their own. So to please the people that we promote marrabenta, we promote your own music. So that is kind of music. So marrabenta even today is the it represents Mozambican music.
Okay, I want to throw out a question there and see how you guys handle this. My impression, I might be wrong, correct me, but my impression is that for those musicians that I've been citing here and we've been talking about, they have been very successful, but it would seem that their success, most of them had crossed over the Atlantic to Europe and the US for them to register successes. Doesn't mean African musicians cannot register success back at home. Must they cross over here to register success?
That's true. For example, like an example in Senegal. In Senegal, they have quite a lot of musician who get their success because of they open their music to the world. For example, you have in Senegal, you have example like Baba Mal, like Yusundur. He think with the all the, for example, Nene Cherry and Sting. And Peter Gabriel and all of them, but it was that the Mbala style. It was a music who excites and who is very successful in Senegal. But the thing is, when he play it, when he go to concert in France and things like that, people doesn't understand that how it's work and things like that. That's why he start to make the Mbala soft. To make it softer to people who can understand, who can know to know how to move, the move of Mbala. And when he collaborate with Nene Cherry, Sting, Peter Gabriel, I think, that's what's making him access to the Western public. And from that time, then he start even mix the Mbala and the Western style of music. And that's for him, when he explaining, it's the way for him to get to the Western public. If not, it will be just in Senegal. Okay, for example, you know that there are a group called Touré Kunda. Those guys are very successful in France, and that's the same. It's from the south of the southern part of Senegal. Generally, in Africa, you have every country have a lot of group of they have a lot of ethnic groups. For example, like in Cameroon, you have some in Nigeria, you have more than 200. In Cameroon, something like more than 150. And there are a lot of rivalities who is making that. When one group, the style of music, if one group is going, having success, and I'm sorry to say that, but there are some other groups who is becoming careless. And sometimes another group, when you get to the power, can push to the other group.
And I'm sure in terms of Cameroon, you quote Bikutsi and Makossa.
Exactly. And but in Senegal, like in the south of Senegal, there are a lot of the type of culture there. It's very rich culturally. And they have their own style of music. But right now, the majority of the population is like the Wolof, which is playing, that's the group who is playing the bala. And that's why, for example, the others, they can't reach to the top. That's exactly what is happening, for example, in Cameroon. And for example, I want to talk about us. I'm not a Cameroonian.
I know that.
I'm a Senegalese, grew up in an area in Dakar where there are a lot of Cameroonians, a lot of Congolese and things like that. But we know that they have a rhythm. The Makossa is a group, a style of music in Africa who went, who quite doesn't exist because of the tribalism. For example,
okay, Hanbala, let me just cut you.
Yeah,
we can
back just
to that.
Add something on that.
Yeah, please.
Or two. Yeah. What I wanna ask you, my brother? Yes, people are playing. People are trying to develop. But on your side, do you think that people are now playing music for entertainment or for business?
Don't answer that. I'll come to that. Okay. But let me ask you guys a follow-up question to the one I asked before. There are musicians like, if I say Sam Fantuma, I'm sure you would know of him, am I right? Or if I call, Koffi Olomide, you would certainly. These are guys, Alhaji Touré, Toto Guillaume, these are good musicians, as far as I can tell, in terms of instruments. They have been very successful, but their success wasn't registered overseas. How do you explain? Whatever they sing, I don't understand, by the way. I come from Cameroon, but I don't understand what they sing about. But then how would you explain that a guy like Sam Fantuma, he is very, very, very successful, say, in East Africa. How would you explain that? They don't understand what he sings, anything at all. But how would you explain that success?
Yeah, let me say this, my brother. If we can look at it about our old brothers, you know, they were well-disciplined, dedicated, determined. And if you look at ourselves now, it's just like what I've just said earlier on. You know, most of our guys, we are not even after quality. We are just after, you know, if I can get some, you know, 5 crowns so that I can buy some bread tomorrow. You know, but those guys were not after that. They were after spreading and sharing the reality part of it from Africa, not just let's just play. And you know, I don't know, what do you think, Celso?
What you say is right. That's why a lot of new African music have been losing the ground, the orientation, the basic. You understand? For example, I can say to you, example, in Guinea-Bissau, they have a traditional group, a traditional style of music called Gumbe. Gumbe, the 70s, for example, you was having groups like Mama Jumbo, Super Mama Jumbo. They was having also a lot of groups who is always playing real Gumbe. But nowadays, it's about the business, and that's why a young Bissau Guinean can say to you, I'm playing Gumbe. But what you hear, it's a lot of techno inside. You understand? It's about business. The thing about to show who you are doesn't exist anymore. It's about business to have money and things like that. That's the same way, for example, like in where I grew up in Dakar, it's a lot of Cavergian. Now I'm talking about the Cavergian music. Cavergian music, they have, for example, traditional music like Batuki, they have Funana, but when the Zouk came from the Caribbean,
the West Indies,
and the Latino have been taking over, and now the Cavergian, they create their own Cabo music. For example, in Dakar, you have having a lot of Cavergian music, like a musician like Manu Lima. Nowadays, it's Philip Montero and Jacqueline Fortes and things like that. But all that have been changing now until you have now the Kizomba, who is coming from Angola. But now, because of all this business, because when we, our artists, get inside to the, they say we do the music for the business. Business is business. Then the Latino, they have been taking over the Kizomba now. Nowadays, if you go to the USA, you say Kizomba, they say, yeah, I know what is Kizomba. You ask them, what kind of music is this? Latino music. Today you say Kuduro, they say it's Latino music. Because, okay, it's business. But now, what you create for your own, it doesn't belong to you anymore.
But
that's why an Angolan can say, oh.
Celso, you're a musician.
That's right.
Both of you are musicians. Would you, and you're playing in this present generation, would you say you're doing music for business or you're doing music for music itself?
Right. This is a very good question. I'm doing music as a way of cultural preservation. Of course, the business minded is always, someone comes, okay, I like your music, I pay so much, let's go in the studio and stuff like that, and you have to change your music to be able to please my
audience.
What I'm gonna do, because I need to survive. But I'm fighting to preserve the culture where I come from, because now it's dying. Like you say, people now are changing the music. I go to my country, I don't recognize the rhythms, because now it's just techno. Like, we musicians, we actually don't need to do much, because because generally you just come on anyway. Everyone can just make their music home. Just press some buttons. You go wherever you go, it's the same music. So there's no difference.
Yeah, that is present music, right?
That's present music.
And yeah,
what I wanted to say, for example, like that time I didn't know. If you, for example, you come with your music, you present who you are.
Right.
You present who you are. And even you mix yourself, for example, you want to do the cultural meeting, you want to meet another culture, then you can't play with, we do that. For example, Swedish groups meet with African, we play together, and we do a combination of different culture.
That's right.
But it's not even that now anymore. It's about business, it's about money, it's about
bling bling.
Who you are and things like that. It doesn't exist anymore.
My brother, do you know that a long time ago, our governments used to finance culture. But nowadays, culture is nothing. they are turning culture into politics. You understand?
Yes.
Especially like when I came to Sweden, I came through culture. My government contributed. Even the Swedish government contributed. But nowadays, even if you write a project proposal, you ask for any cultural activity, first, you know, the political has to make a decision, yeah. Not the cultural people. And let me warn you this, you know, I'm writing a book, my brother, called Flashback Identity. And it has all this, I'm touching everywhere, all angles. I want to bring out these issues because they are pressing us down. Why? We don't want, we are fed up. Enough is enough. We don't want oppression in culture. Politics is taking culture like a nullity.
Yeah.
Culture is nothing to people. We can just sit here and discuss, but you know, we are nothing, brother. Ask him how many times. Or you, this guy works a lot. Is he rich? No man. He's still crying. You understand? But he works more than anybody. Spreading culture. Ask about his country, Mozambique. What have they done to him? Nothing. You understand? Those politicians are sitting there in their offices, enjoying big stomachs, and you know, we are suffering, spreading culture.
ManLuckerz, I agree with you completely, 100%. But then I was wondering, don't you think the audience too has a part to play in this? I wonder how many persons will sit in an audience to listen to traditional African music compared to if a guy like, say, I don't know, P Square from Nigeria or Two Face Idibia were to perform on stage. Don't you think the audience itself or the generation that we're living in now, in terms of digitalization of music, YouTube and all of this, it has a part to play in this? What do you think?
That's why, my brother, I've mentioned about quality. I am after quality. Why should I just listen for something, you know, with no quality, brother? If something with no quality, you just take it in that, in the grade which suits. You understand? Like, that's why we've been even talking about this early 60s music and the 90s. Those guys used to put time on music. You understand? I still even listen to old music, not this modern music. It's nothing for me.
Celso, you have something to say?
I want to say that, like you're talking about the quality, we're talking about quality, but nowadays you don't even need to be a good singer. You just put a microphone and you digitalize, you change your voice. You can be, a man can sound like a girl can sound like a man. Or you can sing as wrong as possible, but you digitalize. It corrects you, and of course people want to buy this new modern thing. And you come like people do in the countryside, like they sing with their hearts and, you know, drumming. People say, what's that? It doesn't have that synthesizer, that digitalized sound. That's the main problem nowadays.
Yeah, it's the problem that every society faces when, in terms of globalization, it happens, cultures are disappearing. But then, we're going to conclude shortly. I was wondering, this last question or so, I was wondering, what can be done for African music, I mean, real African music quotes, to come back onto the scene, Hanbala?
For me, what I can say, for example, I'm not against the modernizing, the this technology inside the music. I'm not against that. But the only thing is that what is sad is, some beautiful styles of African music, they can include in this technology, and it could work in some way. For example, I can list an old Saint Thomas or Moni Pillet, I don't know. But that kind of, if you can modernize it, it can work. But the thing is, this about to put technology on it, and to don't care anymore, and to just about business and put a lot of other styles inside, and you sell it fine. But nowadays, for example, don't complain if you go into that technology, the globalization, you are mixing yourself just for money, then don't complain one day that other people are taking from your music and making it to their music. And internationally, they are known by your own music. For example, you can see a lot of American now stars finding, making a music very successful. But if you hear a lot of techno now, the rhythm, the way they are doing, it's typically African. It's typically African because you can see the beat. It's techno. You can feel the techno music, the dance music, but the rhythm. You can feel this is African, but it's the consequences. You have to take it. But guess what is sad is a lot of beautiful styles is disappearing. It's good you put technology, but at the same time to not make it disappear, because the music they have a right to that too. You don't have to train. For example, there are a lot of style of music who is very beautiful. You will never hear them anymore, and that's what is sad. Put technology fine, but conserve it and continue to play. That's why now nobody can complain, oh, they are playing African music and India, but that's how it is, the globalization. It's a...
My question, how do you think the music that it's everywhere today, I mean African music, so to speak, do you think it's gonna last, Celso?
All we need is love for the music, and love with music, you show it by promoting, by marketing, by putting it in the industry. So you can play your music and you can whatever, if it doesn't come out, there's no way. So the future of the African music depends on the promotion, on the marketing. Those who can put, those who have the conditions to finance that music, why not?
And you as musicians, what problems do you actually face? You're based in Sweden. What are the problems that you face as musicians?
Yeah, the same as a musician in the countryside. Like, I want to go into a good studio where I know I'm going to find the technology, going to find the good technicians who are going to bring my music, raw music, or digitalized or whatnot, but from the start to that point to the studio, there's a gap there. I don't have the means. So if we've got the support, why not?
In terms of promotion.
That's right.
And ManLuckerz, the final word?
Yeah, what I can say for African culture, African music, if we come together and work together and fight for one goal, I think we can win. And also, for those who are interested in music, must also have aims and objectives towards, not just to play. Think, why am I playing this? Achievement, what do you want to achieve? Is it just only to entertain my brother or him? Or I'm doing it for spreading my culture? Or for my children to learn? Or for what? If we can perfect on that, I think, especially like in this country, especially Sweden, we are learning a lot actually on how to professionalize things, whatever you intend to do.
One final word, Hanbala.
One thing I want to say, for example, with the globalization, all this technology inside the music, I think nowadays the winners, they are the Nigerians, because they have been managing to selectionate all the Africans, all the success, to put it in their technology and mix it with their Nigerian way, and to spread it in the world. That's why right now the Nigerians have been taking over. Every way it's about the Nigerian music, and a lot of them, they do know, you can see, for example, if you can see like Iyanya, he's singing your music, or you can feel this is the old Zayko Langa Langa. But they put it inside, make it professional with good video, and it goes away. You understand? But just the thing is, the Zayko Langa can't complain it was my music, but it's just over. You understand? Just what is sad is that we don't care anymore about the identification. This comes from where it's good. Doesn't matter anymore. That's the only thing I think it's little, you know. But the Nigerian right now, that's why they are dominating. They are making professionalism, and they are making it work, and they spread it in the world. That's the same with the movie business too. The Nigerian, I think, they are very good in business. That's why it's going like this way right now.
Well, one thing is for sure, change is a constant thing. Before it was Cameroon that was heading the African music scene, it moved to Congo, moved to Cote d'Ivoire, and then today it's Nigeria. We accept change the way it is. Tomorrow it's going to be somewhere else. Who knows, Sierra Leone or Uganda?
Yes.
We never know.
I just want to make this out that, you know, African people in Sweden, especially always with culture, they are not serious. They are just players, to be honest. I've done a very big research and I've seen it. So we cannot say, how can we achieve this? How can we go more further? I don't think so. Because it's only like, you know, each man for himself. That's why.
So in other words, the government back there need to do something to promote the culture. Thank you, ManLuckerz, thank you, Celso, thank you, Hanbala, for this interesting debate. And thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for watching and listening. We call it a night with this. Thank you very much.